Good evening. We want to welcome you to 10th Presbyterian Church. The Boice Center is sponsoring this evening a lecture and conversation. So part of this is to hear from Mr. Skeel, but also allow time for you to dialogue with him regarding his book, True Paradox. Hopefully you've been able to read sections, if not the whole book. And just thank you for coming this evening. This is the real purpose of the Boice Center. As Dr. Gallagher set it out as an initiative where God's people are learning and thinking about ways that we can not only test our faith, but also interact with others about our faith in Jesus Christ. So it's just a pleasure to have you here this evening. Our guest, David Skeel, is the S. Samuel Arsht Professor of Corporate Law at the University of Pennsylvania. He holds a BA from the University of North Carolina and his JD from the University of Virginia. He's written a number of books on bankruptcy and corporate law, and as well, he has published a number of articles and chapters in books. And most importantly for us this evening, he has now published through InterVarsity the book True Paradox that we will talk about this evening. As well, he and his wife and family are members here at 10th Church, and he is a ruling elder of this church. So let's pray as we do begin. Our Father, we thank you for this evening. We thank you for the work and the labors of this past week, for the many ways that you have taken us in different areas of this city and beyond. And we thank you for your care and provision of us in that. And thank you for the privilege of interacting with those of like precious faith, even this evening, but even throughout the week, the privilege of interacting with those who know not our Savior Jesus Christ. Bless this evening. We thank you for this time to think about our world and the place that you have placed us, even within this very city. And we ask that you would go before us this evening in our conversation, in the ways that we hear and the way we process these things, we pray in Jesus' name, amen.
Thanks, George, and thanks to all of y'all for coming. And I feel like I should start out by saying it's an honor to be doing something that is associated with the name of Jim Boice. I think it was a wonderful thing when Liam Gallagher set up this center. It was one of the great privileges of my life to listen to Jim Boice, to be in this church when Jim Boice was teaching and preaching and telling us about Christ. So anything associated with his name, I'm happy to be a part of, but you will quickly see that I'm no Jim Boice. I knew Jim Boice, and I'm not Jim Boice. What I'd like to do for my part, my talking part of this evening, is two things. I'd like to talk for a couple of minutes about the apologetic strategy of this book, and in particular, a perception that I've had in recent years, it kind of is behind this book in many respects, that some of the traditional ways of doing Christian apologetics, and what I mean by apologetics is defending the Christian faith, don't reach this culture as effectively as they might have 20 or 30 years ago. So I want to start by talking briefly about a couple of landmarks of the last 70 years, still landmarks of Christian apologetics, and what I see as their limitation. They're still crucially important, the things I'll be talking about, but I think in our particular generation, they're not quite the reach is not quite as broad as it once was. And then the second thing I want to do is just talk a little bit about the book and give you an overview of the book, some of the ideas in the book, in the hope that it will stimulate a conversation about some of these issues, how to think about Christianity, what Christianity can and can't provide, or I think it provides everything, but what it is particularly well suited to provide in this generation. So two things, just the apologetic strategy of the book and then a bit about the book itself. So the traditional apologetic strategy, going back to for the last 70 years or so, and if we were in the Q&A part, I would say, when I'm thinking back 70 years, what am I thinking of? And what you would say is C.S. Lewis, Mere Christianity. And I would say, yes, that is what I'm thinking of. But I won't do that because we're not having a conversation quite yet. The traditional apologetic strategies of the last 70 years or so have tended to focus on the objective structure of morality and have tended to make an argument that apart from theism in general, Christianity in particular, there's no objective basis for morality. Now, I think that's true. I think it still is very important, but I'm going to make an argument in a minute that there are a lot of folks, particularly millennials, in the current culture that this doesn't reach quite as well as it did 70 years ago or 20 years ago even. So 70 years ago, C.S. Lewis began giving the talks that became Mere Christianity. So Mere Christianity, as many people here probably know, began as a series of short wartime radio talks that C.S. Lewis gave to present Christianity and to defend Christianity to a British radio audience during World War II. As you may remember, if you've read Mere Christianity recently, Lewis starts out by saying that all of us from our earliest age have a sense of right and wrong. That we have a very strong sense, even when we're children, that some things are fair, some things aren't fair, some things are right, some things are not right. And he argues that that's our first evidence of the moral structure of the universe, that there is a moral structure to the universe. And then he goes on to argue that each one of us has violated that moral structure, objective right and wrong, and we need a savior, and the savior is Jesus, and he talks about Jesus, and he talks about Christianity. So the starting point is the idea that there is an objective basis for morality. There is a moral structure to the universe. That's the heart of what Mere Christianity is about, and it is still the most brilliant Christian apologetics book of the last century, in my view. When I was writing True Paradox, I literally had Mere Christianity on my desk as I was writing, and it was one of the most depressing things I ever did. Because you'd read a sentence of Mere Christianity, and then you'd look at the sentence on your laptop, and you'd say, one of these two things doesn't belong. But it's not the sentence from Mere Christianity. Mere Christianity is the apologetics that many of us grew up on, or many of us who have become Christians in the last couple of generations read sometime early in that time. If you fast forward 20 or 30 years, so Mere Christianity was given as originally as radio talks in the early 1940s. It was published in 1952. If you fast forward 10 to 20 years, the other major landmark apologetics approach that I want to point to was Francis Schaeffer, whom many of us in this room probably know. Probably many people don't know Francis Schaeffer. If you don't know Francis Schaeffer, the way I would put him in context is, in my view, Tim Keller, who most everybody in this room probably does know, uses a very similar apologetic strategy to the strategy that Francis Schaeffer used in the 1960s and 1970s. Tim Keller has updated the strategy for a more heterogeneous culture, a more pluralistic world, but it's a very similar kind of strategy. The way the strategy was done by Francis Schaeffer. Francis Schaeffer was a Presbyterian minister. In the 1960s, he went to Switzerland and set up a retreat center called Le Brie. And the idea of the retreat center is if you had questions, if you were a Christian and you had questions you wanted to ask, or if you weren't a Christian and you wanted to pose questions, you could go to Le Brie. Le Brie is, there still are Le Bries in a number of different places, and talk about Christianity, and you would hear from Francis Schaeffer, and you would probably read his books. His basic strategy is a strategy that pushes people to recognize that if you're not a theist, if you don't believe in God, there is no objective basis for your morality. So his argument is theism in general, Christianity in particular, provides an objective basis for our obligations to act right and not wrong, an objective basis for morality. If you're not a theist, you have no objective basis for your sense of right and wrong. And what Schaefer would say is if you're honest with yourself and you're not a theist, then the ultimate outcome of your worldview is despair. That if you're serious about the implications of what you believe, there's no objective foundation for them. If you're honest with yourself, you will end up in despair. And Francis Schaefer made these arguments by working his way through the history of philosophy and the history of art. In his time, which was the 1960s and 1970s, existentialism was very popular on college campuses. And so we talked a lot about existentialism, praised existentialism and the existentialists as being honest about the implications of their beliefs, that they did lead to despair, although he also pointed out that the existentialists tended not to be consistent about their beliefs. They argued that there is no objective truth and that life is about an act of will, not about truth. And yet when push came to shove, most of the existentialists acted as if they believed there really was truth. So Jean-Paul Sartre came out in favor of the Algerian revolution, Algeria's revolution against France, and said it was a righteous revolution, which suggested that he believed there actually is a right, a right and wrong, a moral order. Francis Schaefer also talked about a number of poets and authors. He was a big fan of Dylan Thomas because he thought Dylan Thomas, the Irish poet, was honest about the despair that's the natural implication of his belief. So the general thrust of the argument is ask the person you're talking to what they believe, what the basis for what they believe, and prod them on that. And if they are a Christian, they will have an objective foundation for what they believe. If they're not, they won't have any objective foundation. And Francis Schaefer's idea, and it was very, very effective, was that's a way to push people to take Christianity seriously. Once they realize there's no objective foundation for what they believe, they'll say, well, why do I believe what I believe? And shouldn't I take seriously this other view that does give me an objective foundation? In my experience, when you do this sort of apologetic strategy, if you engage in this kind of a conversation with many millennials, my students are almost all millennials, and I don't want to tar millennials too much. I think this is true more generally in our culture, but it's particularly true of millennials, people who are in their 20s and early 30s. If you show them that on the one hand, they really do believe some things are right and some things are wrong. So, for instance, they really believe sex trafficking is wrong. But you show them on the other hand that they don't have any objective foundation for what they believe if they're not a theist. So if you show a millennial that they believe there's right and wrong, but they don't have any objective basis for it, instead of saying, well, come tell me about Christianity, in my experience, what they tend to say is, so what? And that's the first thing they say. The second thing they say is, wow, that's kind of cool. I'm a pretty complicated person. I can believe these two things that are inconsistent with each other at the same time, and I can still chew bubblegum or whatever. And so the assumption that when people realize they don't have an objective basis for what they believe to be true, the assumption that causing people to realize that will make them take Christianity seriously, for many millennials and for many people in our culture now, is no longer an accurate assumption. Now, I don't want to say those kinds of arguments are bad arguments. I still think Mere Christianity is the best apologetics book out there. I think Francis Schaeffer's work is amazing. I think Tim Keller's work is really incredible, and his ministry is really incredible. My point instead is that for many people, that's not a conversation that you can really have with them and get anywhere with them unless they first come to conclude that there's a reason to take Christianity seriously. Showing them that they don't have an objective basis for their morality really just does not make any headway with many people in our culture. So what does apologetics need in the 21st century? In my view, apologetics, particularly for millennials, for young Americans in particular, has to do two things to be effective. The first thing it has to do is it has to engage what I call the narrative of scientific progress. And the narrative of scientific progress goes like this. 200 years ago, there were lots of mysteries in the world. We didn't understand how the solar system worked. We didn't know anything about subatomic particles. In that world 200 years ago, when so many things were mysterious, people needed God as an explanation for those mysteries. God was how you explained how the universe came into being, what an atom is, what an atom does. In the past 200 years, this narrative goes, science has answered many of these questions. We know how planets move. We know what the Earth is like. We know something about subatomic particles. And this narrative, which I might call the myth of scientific progress, says science is on its way to explaining all of these puzzles. We don't need religion anymore because science is providing answers for us. An effective apologetics for a non-Christian in our culture now has to engage that narrative. You have to have something to say about why the narrative of scientific progress is problematic and is inaccurate. The second thing apologetics needs to do, in my view, in this generation, is it has to have something to say about social justice. If you don't say anything about social justice, people just aren't going to be interested in what you have to say. And we've, I think, seen lots of evidence of that even in the last few weeks. So what I try to do in this book is to at least gesture in this kind of a direction. Try to provide a book that engages the narrative of scientific progress, also says something about social justice. So how do I do that in this book, or what does this book try to do? Well, the starting point of the book is a very common perception about Christianity and complexity. And the way this common perception goes is the world that we live in now is way too complex for a 2,000-year-old religion to have anything useful to say about it. How in the world can a 2,000-year-old religion like Christianity speak to the contemporary world? It's not up to the complexity of the contemporary world. In my conversations with atheist friends of mine, I get this argument all this time, or this comment all the time, and for some reason, they have a particular fascination with two words when they talk about Christianity's inadequacy and its inability to deal with complexity. Those two words are Bronze Age. I have had two different atheist friends send me emails saying, you know, I love you, David. You're a very good friend, but what is it with this Bronze Age religion that you adhere to? And I quote from one of them in the beginning of the book, and I'll read you. This is a direct quote from an email to him. This is a friend of mine who's actually a postdoc student over at Penn. Who was my conversation partner for the entire time I was writing the book, and he gave me great comments on the book, long email with detailed suggestions for the book. And at the beginning of the email, he said, something to the effect that I found the book really interesting. I found myself scratching my head and really having to rethink things a little bit. But at the end of the day, I wasn't persuaded, he said. And here's how he said it. He said he still believes, and here's the quote, that Christianity appears to be not much more than a human creation of Bronze Age peasants derived from wholly unexceptional and largely fictional narratives. So these are what my friends say to me when they are emailing me. So the argument of this book is that this perception is actually exactly backwards, and that if you look at some of the puzzles and paradoxes of how we actually experience the world, of how as human beings we experience the world, there are a number of puzzles and paradoxes that what I call a science without God view of the universe, or a materialist view of the universe, cannot explain very effectively, but for which Christianity has really good, interesting explanations. So the argument is Christianity actually has more to say about the complexity of our subjective experience of the world than the leading alternative on offer, at least in my world and in many of your worlds, which is not another religion, it is a science without religion view of the world. So there are five main chapters in the book. The first chapter is about consciousness and what I call our idea-making capacity and trying to make sense of that. The second chapter is about beauty and the way we experience beauty. The third chapter is about suffering and how we experience suffering. The fourth chapter is about justice, our longing for justice and yet our inability to achieve justice. And then the final chapter is about the afterlife. So what I thought I would do with the few more minutes before I open things up to questions, I have a few more minutes, is just briefly go through the chapters, and I'll spend a little bit more time on the earlier ones and a little less time on the later ones to leave some time for questions. So again, the five chapters are consciousness is the first chapter, second is beauty, third is suffering, fourth is justice, and the last one is the afterlife, heaven and the afterlife. So starting with consciousness, I start out this chapter by pointing out the obvious fact that from a science without God perspective, we really do not have a good explanation for human consciousness, or what I call our idea-making capacity, our ability to formulate abstract ideas about the way the universe works and our place in it. And things of that sort. Abstract thought obviously includes a lot more than that. So from a science without God perspective, what do we have to say about that? Well, what we have to say about this at this point is we really don't know why we have consciousness. That if you look back at the ancient humans on the mythical savanna of 30 or 40,000 years ago, you can imagine why it might be adaptive for human beings to have basic language skills, to be able to communicate with one another. It might be useful to be able to engage in a little bit of planning. It's not obvious why human beings need to be able to debate Kant or John Stuart Mill. There's just not a good evolutionary explanation for why we need that level of abstract thought. Now, I want to stop here to underscore that I'm not making an argument that we'll never have good evolutionary or science without God explanations for consciousness. We may someday, and I think the explanations will get better through time. The point that I'm making is simply that we don't have good explanations now. Even somebody like Steven Pinker, the psychologist and linguist at Harvard who wrote a book about the mind and purports to explain how the mind works, even Steven Pinker says we don't have a clue why we have consciousness and how consciousness arose. If you shift from a science without God perspective to a Christian perspective, Christianity has some really interesting things to say about why we have consciousness and what the purpose of consciousness is. What the Bible tells us is that the universe is rational, It was created by a rational God. It was created as a reflection of that rational God. So it's not surprising that there is a rationality to the universe, so that when you look at passages like the beginning of Psalm 19, where it says, "The heavens declare the glory of God," or Proverbs 3:19, which says, "The Lord by wisdom founded the earth, by understanding he established the heavens," the picture we get is of a God that is rational, creating a universe that is beautiful and is rational. We are told by the Bible that we were created in the image of that rational God. So it's not surprising that we have the capacity to understand how the universe works. It's not surprising either that the universe is in fact rational, which it didn't have to be. The universe did not have to be rational. In fact, Einstein said the most incomprehensible thing to him, to Einstein, is that the universe is comprehensible. Because there's no reason that the universe needs to be rational, and yet it is, and the Bible tells us to expect that. The Bible also suggests that we human beings ought to have the rational capacity to understand or to make sense of the universe. And so the fact that we have the ability to understand the universe from a Christian perspective is not surprising at all. And I give a bunch of illustrations of this in the chapter. My favorite illustration of this idea, the idea that we're made in the image of a rational God, and so it's not surprising that we have rationality, and that that rationality is somehow in tune in some way with the way the universe works. My favorite example is an article written by a scholar who was not a Christian in 1960. And the article is called "The Unreasonable Effectiveness of Mathematics in the Natural Sciences." The Unreasonable Effectiveness of Mathematics in the Natural Sciences. What the article is about is the number of times throughout history that completely abstract mathematical ideas, mathematical principles that were created for the purposes of fulfilling a theorem, and there was no reason to believe they had any real significance, repeatedly throughout history, abstract mathematical ideas have turned out to tell us something about how the universe works. One of the best examples of this, which is an example I don't understand either, is probably most of you won't either, so I won't take questions about this example. But the example is imaginary numbers, which I believe is a number times the square root of -1. Completely artificial concept. When it was devised, it turns out to be essential to understanding subatomic particles. It's at the heart of subatomic physics. From a science without God perspective, this is just mystifying. It's as if we somehow hit the cosmic jackpot. We accidentally got this mind that accidentally seems to be tuned in some way to the way the universe works. And there are a number of other examples of that sort throughout history. Just a quick reference to one of the other arguments that I make, or maybe slightly more than a quick reference, very different kind of argument I make in this chapter is it seems to me that if your religion or system of thought is true or is plausibly true, it ought to help you better navigate your way through the universe and navigate your way through daily life. One implication of that, if that's right, is that testimonies are evidence of the truth of Christianity. So to the extent that a religion or system of thought, if it's true, if it's plausibly true, will help you better navigate your life, when somebody says, "I was lost, but now I'm found," "I was blind, but now I see, that's a little bit of evidence of the truth of that system of thought. And one of the things that really has struck me about the new atheist writings of the last couple of years, writings by people like Richard Dawkins and Sam Harris, is they seem to have recognized that, because a number of the recent New Atheist books are books trying to show that believing an atheist view of the universe can help you live a fulfilled life. If you understand that you're part of the great web of the universe, that will help you live better. So Richard Dawkins wrote a book called The Magic of Reality that has that kind of feel to it. Sam Harris just wrote a book, I think it's called Waking Up, similar kind of book. If 20 years from now, we see all over the world people saying, I read The New Atheist and now my life has been transformed, that will be some evidence that that atheism is a plausible understanding of the world. I personally don't think that's what we're going to see. I think that one of the really remarkable things about Christianity is that we see testimonies like this in every culture, in every time, every race, no matter what the world is like. Whenever Christianity has not been forcefully repressed, people have turned to Christianity and have given testimony to how it has transformed their life. And I believe that that is a piece of evidence of the plausibility of Christianity. Not proof, but a little bit of evidence of the plausibility. Okay, so the second chapter is about beauty. And what I have in mind here, what I talk about in this chapter, is the sense of transcendence that we experience in the presence of beautiful art or a beautiful landscape. And I give an example at the beginning of the chapter of an experience that I had like this. It was after my second year of college. I went out west with two friends of mine, and we drove a van across country so that we could hitchhike in California. We got the van through one of the world's worst business ideas. And the world's worst business idea gave rise to a company called DriveAway, which does not exist anymore, for good reason, I think. And the idea of DriveAway was that if somebody needed a car on the other side of the country, but they didn't have time to drive it across the country themselves, what they could do is they could go to this company. The company would find a college student who's looking for a car to drive across the country. The college student would drive it across the country, and everybody would be happy at the end of it. What they didn't reckon with is that when college students like me and my friends driving this van drive cars across the country, the van is not the same vehicle at the other side of the country that it is on this side of the country. But fortunately, they didn't figure this out until after I graduated from college. So these two friends and I drove across the country in a van. We got to California. We hitchhiked up the coast of California. You can't do that anymore, but back then it was actually fairly safe to hitchhike in California. The idea was that we were going to find great jobs, we were going to make lots of money, and then we were going to travel the rest of the time. We traveled a bit, we didn't find the great jobs, we didn't make lots of money, and so my two friends had to come back east to have a real job. So my two friends left, and I continued hitchhiking by myself, and a day or two after they had gone back east, I was hitchhiking in Northern California, in the Redwood region of California. It got to be the middle of the afternoon. I couldn't get a ride. Looking at me now, you can probably imagine why I wasn't getting rides. It got to be later. I still couldn't get a ride. It started getting dark. I still couldn't get a ride. I finally gave up. I ended up spending the night in my sleeping bag on the side of the road in Northern California, waking up at about 4 o'clock in the morning when it first started to get light, soaking wet. My sleeping bag was soaking wet. I kept a diary, unfortunately, and so you can imagine what the diary entry looked like. The world is terrible. Sartre was right. There is no hope. Everything is awful. I was feeling a little bit sorry for myself. I wake up. I write in my diary, I get up, I put my backpack back together, start walking up the road. walk around a corner, and it's an overlook looking over the redwood trees. There's fog nestled in the trees and a mist, and the sun is just starting to rise. It was one of the most beautiful things I'd ever seen in my life, and I just had this sense of absolute transcendence, that this must be the way the universe is meant to be, that this is telling me something about the way the universe is. And as is often the case, and almost always the case with these kinds of experiences, a sense not just of transcendence, but also of melancholy, because I knew that 5 minutes from then, I was going to be back walking along the road, soaking wet with my backpack. So the experience that I'm trying to think about in this chapter is that experience of transcendence, which is invariably accompanied with melancholy, with a recognition that we're getting this glimpse and the glimpse is imperfect and it's temporary. So what does the science without God perspective of the world have to say about that? That experience of transcendence we have in the presence of beauty? Well, evolutionary scientists don't have really good explanations at all for the phenomenon of beauty, and just the way beauty affects us in general, and even more specifically, the sense of transcendence I was referring to. The current accounts of beauty in evolutionary science, in science without God perspectives of the world, tend to take one of two directions. One form of explanation says that our experience of beauty is just an accident. It's just an evolutionary accident. It was not necessary for us to feel the way that we feel in the presence of beauty. It just kind of happened. It was an evolutionary accident. This is the view that Stephen Jay Gould, the Harvard paleontologist, took. He said, our perception of beauty is just an evolutionary accident. It doesn't have any practical usefulness. The other direction is that some science without God folks take the position that we can explain beauty and that it has an evolutionary explanation. This is the perspective that that Steven Pinker has taken, and the kind of explanation that he credits for the beauty that we see in nature is an explanation. He didn't create it himself. He's drawing on other scientists. An explanation that the reason we feel a sense of transcendence when we feel a beautiful landscape is because for ancient human beings, it's likely that landscape would have had food. And so the reason we feel beauty is we feel beauty because it's a clue as to whether the landscape was likely to have food. I don't know what Steven Pinker would have to say about those of us who think desert landscapes are beautiful. And this general argument, it's taken completely seriously, but it has, to me, the feel of a stab in the dark that we don't really know. With art, in the sense of beauty that we have in art, one of the standard current explanations, is that we experience beauty in art the way we do because it helps with social cohesion. That if we respond to beautiful art, that will draw us together as a culture, and therefore it had an evolutionary usefulness for us. You don't have to think very long to think of all the counterexamples to that. It might be true that when Americans see the painting of George Washington crossing the Delaware River, we feel a little bit patriotic, but lots of art that we would say is beautiful does not draw us together. This too has a little bit of a feel of a stab in the dark. Again, I'm not making an argument that there will never be good explanations for why it would be useful for us to have a sense of transcendence in the presence of beauty. What I am saying is we don't have those explanations now, And the argument that beauty is just an accident is deeply, deeply unsatisfying. It's saying that something that is central to our experience as human beings, that most of us view as one of the most important things in our life, it's an argument that that's irrelevant, it's just an accident. So what does Christianity say about beauty? Well, Christianity says a lot of things about beauty, and I talk about a variety of different things that Christianity has to say about beauty in the chapter. But in general, what Christianity says is that sense of transcendence we have, and that sense that our experience of beauty is telling us something about the universe, is not an accident. In fact, it's right. That the universe was created beautiful, and when we have the experience of beauty, we are having a momentary glimpse of the way the universe was meant to be, and the way the Bible promises the universe will one day, once again, be. That sense of melancholy we have, Christianity explains as also being true. The reason that we feel melancholy in the presence of beauty is because the beauty of the universe has been corrupted. The universe is broken. It is fallen. It needs to be restored. It is not what it was meant to be, and what Christianity teaches that it will one day be. I think Christianity also has interesting things to say about the creation of beauty. So when we think about creating beauty, one of the things that I think about is the phenomenon that psychologists refer to as flow. That moment when artists sometimes have, and people have in other contexts as well, where you feel like you're being transported beyond yourself and you are doing what you are meant to be doing, that you are in the mode you are meant to be in. Christianity says that's not an accident, that is in fact a hint of what we are meant to be, and that when we create, because we are made in the image of a creator God, when we create, we are reflecting our creator back to himself. We are doing something that is like what our creator God has done, which is what you would expect if we're made in the image of that creator God. So a few words about suffering, and I'll speed up from here. So in the chapter about suffering, the most striking thing that or the most striking things I think I say in that chapter are the first is maybe not a surprise, that in my experience, suffering is the most difficult issue for Christianity to explain. So that when I talk to people who are not Christians, the question of suffering, what people call the problem of evil, is very frequently the first thing they point to. And it is, in my view, the hardest issue for Christianity to explain to people who are not Christians. The surprising conclusion that I reach in this chapter, which some of y'all may not agree with, is I don't believe that Christianity provides a full explanation of suffering. There are several thousand years of very thoughtful analyses of suffering and attempts to explain why a good God would create a world in which we can suffer. Some of the arguments I think are pretty interesting. I personally don't think any of them is fully compelling. So a couple arguments that people tend to use. The main one is an argument from free will. And the argument is that if we were not to have been automatons, if we were to have any personality at all, we had to have the capacity to make bad decisions. And if we had the capacity to make bad decisions, that created the possibility of evil. That's an explanation that C.S. Lewis found compelling, Augustine found compelling. I personally don't find it compelling because I can sort of imagine God creating a world in which
we have complete free will, and yet there's no suffering. You know, we just happen to make decisions that don't produce suffering. Or as an atheist friend of mine, the other friend who referred to Christianity as a Bronze Age religion, told me he can imagine a world in which Hitler, instead of killing millions of Jews, had a penchant for planting tulips. And I can kind of imagine that too. The other explanation that many people credit, and I think there's something to it, but I just don't think it's completely helpful in this context, is an argument that in the end, the world that we are in, the universe that we're in, is the best possible universe in ways that we can't understand. And I think that may be true, and I kind of think it is true, but I don't think that's a full explanation of the problem of evil. That does not answer the questions that somebody who's really wrestling with this has, in my view. So suffering, from a Christian perspective, is puzzling, I believe. But I also believe there's a dimension of suffering that's really puzzling from a science without God perspective. And that dimension of suffering is the way we experience suffering. When we experience suffering or when we see suffering, we don't tend to say, oh, that's just the way the world works. What we tend to say is there's something wrong about that, particularly if it is suffering inflicted by human beings on other human beings. From a science without God perspective, that's a little bit puzzling. And people like Richard Dawkins would argue that we shouldn't experience suffering that way, but even Richard Dawkins seems to experience suffering that way. And my favorite example of that in Richard Dawkins is Richard Dawkins talks about a wasp, and this is a very famous example that goes back to Charles Darwin, talks about a wasp that stings a caterpillar, paralyzing the caterpillar so that the larvae of the wasp can eat the caterpillar alive. And to make it even more gruesome, the larvae of the wasp eat the non-essential organs of the caterpillar first so that the caterpillar will stay alive longer for the larvae to continue to eat. If Richard Dawkins was true to his beliefs, he would say, gosh, that's interesting, that's the way the world works. That's not what he says. What he says when he's talking about this is, I don't know if caterpillars feel pain. I devoutly wish, or devoutly hope, that they don't. He's trying to make a joke there, I think, with his use of the word devout, but it is striking to me that he uses morally laden language, even somebody who is so carefully amoral in the face of suffering as Richard Dawkins does. Unlike a science without God perspective, which has a lot of difficulty explaining the way we experience suffering, Christianity teaches that suffering is wrong, that we're not wrong to treat it as unnatural and not part of the world as it was meant to be. Christianity also teaches that we don't suffer under a God who is remote from our suffering, but our God suffered with us in Jesus Christ, which not only explains or completes the explanation of why we experience suffering the way we do, but transforms that suffering or can transform that suffering. So very briefly, I'll say a couple words about justice and the afterlife. So in the justice paradox, or the justice chapter, I talk about what I call the justice paradox. And what I mean by that is the repeated tendency throughout human history both to think that we are capable of producing a fully just society if we just put the right set of laws in place, and our repeated failure to succeed in that quest. So the combination of thinking we can create a fully just society on the one hand, and on the other hand, repeatedly failing in doing so and failing to learn from that lesson. From a science without God perspective, the response people tend to have is we actually can create a fully just society. This is what my one of my atheist friends said to me is, he said, I think you're wrong, David. I think we can create a fully just society. It's possible he's right, but I don't think he does. I think the alternative view has history on its side. It also has current events on its side. And to the extent we are, well, actually, the Bible has a couple different things to say about that, it seems to me. One is, the Bible explains why we keep thinking we can create a fully just society. And the way the Bible explains it is by showing us that we have an innate desire to make ourselves God. We instinctively think we can become God and we can do the things that God does. So you see that in the Garden of Evil. You do see it in the Garden of Evil. You see it in the Garden of Eden. The fall was based on the belief that Adam and Eve could make themselves like God. The Tower of Babel has that same feel to it. Where Christianity is different from the other monotheistic religions, Islam and Judaism, on this issue, is that Christianity is the only religion that not only explains our hubris, our belief that we can make ourselves God, but Christianity rests on a story in which the hero of the story is murdered by law, and murdered not by terrible legal systems. Jesus was tried twice under two different legal systems. They were not bad legal systems. The Jewish legal system and the Roman legal system were the greatest legal systems the ancient world had ever known up to that point. They both failed, and not only did they fail, but they made the murder worse by giving it the imprimatur of law. Now, Christianity suggests that we can't create a fully just society, but it's not nihilistic about law, and Christianity has a lot of interesting things to say about how to think about law. So Christianity, and I'd love to talk at more length, but I've already gone too long about this. Christianity provides the only adequate foundation for human rights, in my view. It's a different conception of human rights than a non-Christian or a science without God conception. It also provides a way of thinking about the secular law and what the secular law can and can't do. And the argument I make in the book is that what the law can sometimes do is promote relationship in various ways that I talk about in the book. The last chapter of the book is about the afterlife. I talk about things like when you look at Renaissance paintings of heaven and hell, why is it that hell's so interesting and heaven is so boring? I raise and try to answer the question, will there be lawyers in heaven? Quite to the surprise of most people read the book, I believe there will be lawyers in heaven, that it is possible to imagine a lawyer without sin. That's not completely a contradiction in terms. And then I conclude the book by making an argument that the afterlife and our relation to the afterlife is actually connected to all of the other issues that I've been talking about. So when we experience beauty, when we long for justice, when we long for a world without suffering, that gives us a glimpse of what the world will one day be. It's an example of heaven breaking into our daily lives. And what the Bible, I believe, teaches is that one day the universe will be transformed so that our experience of beauty, our longing for justice, will be ubiquitous in the universe. And one implication of that is it suggests that we are, when we contribute to beauty, when we contribute to justice, we are part of that process that God is engaging in. That when Jesus came, he inaugurated the kingdom of heaven, which means we get tastes of it now. When we contribute to justice, when we contribute to beauty, we are making contributions that may have eternal significance. They may be part of God's eternal reclamation project for the universe. Okay, so as usual, I've gone way over, But why don't we take questions if I haven't stunned you into silence?
Mm-hmm.
Oh, in just a second, I think we need a microphone. So I'm not hearing most of your. I'm not hearing a lot of your questions. Why don't we talk after it? I'll talk to you personally.
So for other questions for Professor Skeel, please raise your hand. I'll come and bring the mic.
Thanks so much, Professor.
You're welcome.
I saw you at the Wharton School, postgrad at Wharton School.
Uh-huh.
Yeah. I really agree with you. Your book was such a central theme, apologetic. But when you look at the Christianity now in the 20th century and the first century, if you just take an overview, Christianity seems has lost credibility and authenticity for mostly for young people, a young generation. And we have seen a lot of young people drifting away from anything has to do with Christianity. And in my point of view, I believe that Christianity is the true and central religion. And this I think that can be able to provide eternal life and goodness for humankind. And I would love Christianity to be authentic. I would love Christianity to be reformed in such a way that young people in this modern age, in this modern time, 21st century, can have a gravitating force. And leadership has also to have that credibility, authenticity. And also not only that, but making sure that the message that is there is not a kind of repetition of the same message that was there.
The message is what?
It's not like a repetition of the same message, which is more like monotonous. We are living in a different age now. We need kind of a new doctrinal, liturgical, and different ways of exegesis that can ultimately gravitate to young people, mostly us contemporary who live in this age of the century. So I thought, when I look at the Old Testament, and strictly following the Old Testament as it is, the traditions, the rituals, as well as the New Testament, following the same kind of canonical lineages, the faith and practices that have been already followed 200 years ago over them, that is something that completely, it actually scares away young people. But we have something there in our own religion that can ultimately gravitate young people, inspire them, because the way it used to be 100 years ago. Do we have anything in order to see it about this time?
So can I stop you for just a second? So what is it that you think is scaring people away?
The doctrine of Christianity has actually, it has been completely like a matter of repetition. It doesn't have credibility, it doesn't have authenticity.
And why is that?
It's because it's a doctrine that was already, created or was already drafted and crafted well back over maybe 200 years ago.
So I'm not following. Like, can you give me an example of what you're?
Okay, we look at when Jesus came 2,000 years ago to the people of Israel. He came with the gospel, and he told the people that Mosaic law Mosaic law was Mosaic law in your own time. We're a different age now, and bringing the new dispensation of the gospel. If you set the scripture of Moses, which is the Old Testament, you cannot understand me. And they were sitting restrictive, thinking that in them you'll have eternal life. But what Jesus was speaking, some of them, they are not reading the Mosaic law. They rejected it because they say he came to do away with all of this. Now, 2,000 years ago, since Jesus lived here on earth, in more than 2,000 years ago, at this time, it's 2015. Now, at this particular time, we have different generation now. Ourselves a different generation. That's the way at the time of Jesus. They had a different generation.
Can you bring it to a question?
Do we have something in our time, like the gospel of Jesus in their time that he brought, that could give eternal salvation? Do you have anything that you can extrapolate and ever write to the people, to young people, that, oh, this is the new liberation of truth, this is a new dispensation, this era, that is more higher level, that can elevate us to a higher level, that can understand the truth authentically?
We could talk about this a little more after maybe as well, but my reaction is, the core of the gospel doesn't change, and I think that's absolutely essential to Christianity. I mean, there are different ways that it manifests itself, and different ways that we speak to different cultures and in different times, but the core doesn't change, and that's at the heart of what is most powerful about Christianity, is it doesn't change through time. So that when Jesus is talking about a new dispensation, he's also saying that he didn't abolish any of the Old Testament. He fulfilled all of the Old Testament. So it seems to me the issue is not altering the core, it's more about introducing people to that core and what is the best way to introduce them to it. But we can talk about this some more after, if you'd like.
David, that was an excellent talk.
Thank you, Bob.
Very simple question. What do you think is the future relationship between democracy and Christianity?
you did say simple, you didn't say easy. You could answer this in a lot of different ways, and there are some interesting things that have happened in the last few years. So I don't believe that that Christianity necessarily teaches democracy as the right system of government in every country. So a good example of that, in my view, has been the Arab Spring, where people thought if we toppled the dictators, or if the dictators were toppled in the Middle Eastern countries and you put democracy in place, everything would be better, and that's not what's happened. We've ended up in a number of Middle Eastern countries with governments that are worse than what we had before. So not every country is ready for a democracy, it doesn't seem to me. So I wouldn't say democracy is the answer everywhere. I don't think that was at your heart of your question. I think your heart of your question was more probably what do we see for democracy in this country, and where is that going? I'm not sure where that's going. We're living in a really strange time, I think. But I'm not a complete pessimist. I was talking to a student about this last week, and he summarized my comments as hopeful but cautious about where we're going. We've done well by democracy. We've had some big hiccups in the last generation that in other places could have been completely destabilizing. Bush versus Gore could have been completely destabilizing in another place. And so democracy in this country does seem to me to be quite resilient. And so I am hopeful, although we are living in a difficult time, I think. There's lots more one could say about that as well.
Yeah, concerning the justice paradox in recent events, it seems that people are saying they expect a trial to bring out truth and justice. And I think you in your book kind of disagree with that. And I wish you could address that a little bit in terms of what would you say to people that are looking for truth and justice and think in these situations that the legal system is the panacea and it's going to solve all these problems?
So the specific thing that I say about trials in the book, which I assume is what you're alluding to, is in the beginning of the book, I criticize a couple of other apologetic strategies in addition to the ones I was referring to earlier, one of which is what I call the Darwin on trial apologetic strategy, and it's a strategy that's used, especially with science, but it's used in other areas as well, and the idea is that whatever the issue is, we'll subject it to a trial, and the trial will tell us whether Christianity is true and whether it's not true. And what I say about, the point I make about that is simply that criminal trials are not designed to produce truth. Their objective is not to tell us what's true and what's not true. If they were designed to tell us what's true, we would admit any relevant evidence into the trial. If we have a murder weapon, the murder weapon would be introduced into evidence, even if the police got it through some improper means, but we don't allow murder weapons that have been obtained improperly to be used in trial because we have other objectives. We're concerned about the way the police act. We're concerned about innocent people not going to prison and to making that a priority. So the point in the book is that as an apologetic strategy, I think it's problematic to use lawyerly arguments to defend Christianity. It's not an argument that that trials are a terrible way to achieve justice. I think criminal trials, on the whole, in this country, are pretty good. I mean, they don't produce justice every time, but I think the system overall works relatively well. There's some problems with it that we're seeing right now. I think so. It's not an argument that trials are invariably bad, but it's an argument that we should be clear-eyed about what they're good about and what they're not so good about.
Professor Bork at Harvard was denied an office in the Supreme Court because he believed that the ball came from infinite, omniscient, all-knowing God. Where does ball come from the relativists today?
It's another short question that does not admit of a simple answer. So there's, as you know, there is a long philosophical argument about that. But the two major perspectives on offer. One is a natural law kind of perspective, which is consistent with a biblical perspective, and I believe that that Christianity teaches that natural law is the structure of the way things work. I mean, there's lots of room for debate beyond that point. There are secular versions of natural law. I don't find them particularly compelling, but the two major approaches are some kind of natural law, or what I'll call loosely a natural law approach, on the other hand, and on the other hand, what's known as positivist law, which is really oversimplifying that the law is what we say it is, which generates a lot of problems. There is a lively debate in legal circles today about what the appropriate source of law is. It's not a pure all secularists are positivists and all non-secularists are natural law advocates. But many fall into those two categories.
Thanks a lot, Dr. Skeel. In terms of the application, where we should go from here, I think something to talk about with not using the trial method, we don't want to scare people away who aren't believers. We don't want to try and beat them over the head, like some apologists do. What are the kinds of questions we should be asking people to just make them think about the things that you raise in your book? What are the kinds of conversations we should be having as believers to just have productive conversations and make people think about this?
That's a great question. So I increasingly think that for people who don't think Christianity is plausible, that they're just not going to engage Christianity unless you persuade them that it's worth engaging, I really think that beauty is the way forward. I mean, I just think that that people inherently have a sense of the importance of beauty and that being central to who we are. And I would put that together with consciousness as well. And there's a real tendency for science without God types to flatten out that complexity, just to treat beauty and the sense of transcendence as if it doesn't matter. And I mean, the way I would start a conversation is, well, what do you make of that? What do you think is beautiful? Why do you think it's beautiful? I think that's helpful. I do think at some point, if people are at least thinking about Christianity, you do want to ask the questions about objective morality. What do you think the basis of morality is? I found in my conversations with my atheist friends, they will generally admit that they do not have any basis for their morality, and that the question that I don't think there's an atheist answer to is, why should we do what's right? You know, even if we agree on what descriptively is right, why should we do what's right? There isn't a good atheist answer for that. That there's no basis for moral obligation, and there's no objective basis for morality. So I still think that conversation is important, and C.S. Lewis is great on that, Tim Keller is great on that, but many people just aren't interested in having that conversation, and so I think beauty is the way forward. I mean, my hope is that Christian poets and writers and novelists will be standing at places like this more often, because I think they're the folks that are going to reach people. In a sense, yes. I mean, I think that is a big part of the argument. It's not the way I'm making the argument. I think that is what they're doing, but I'm more inclined to focus on what are the implications of trying to explain the universe without the designer, and just pointing out how much you flatten out the richness of our experience. You treat our mind as if it's just a machine that doesn't have any of the capacities that we treat as most distinctively human. You treat our experience of the world is not having anything to do with beauty. So I guess my focus is more at the ground level. It's like it's on us and how we experience the world, but the flip side of that coin is I believe we experience the world the way we do because there is a designer that created us to experience it that way. So yes, I'm making a design and designer argument, but I'm making it from the opposite direction, I think, and starting with our subjective experience of the world, which I do think is the hardest thing for an atheist to explain. Why we have these experiences, and are they just an accident? You know, maybe they're just an accident, but it turns out this accident is central to what it means to be human.
I want to thank Professor Skeel for coming out tonight and
getting this spring lectureship for the Boice Center. Something they put this wonderful, fun, provoking, and insightful. And we're asking any further questions, maybe we can have you come up and discuss with Professor Skeel afterwards. I want to, there's an announcement I think that we want to address. And I want to thank all of you for coming out tonight.
Yeah, thank you, Professor Skeel. And if you are thinking more about the issues that David just raised, or if you know someone who might be, Liam Gallagher, the pastor here at 10th Pres, will be gathering a group of people May 20th and 27th at 6:30, the Black Sheep Pub. It's just up the street from here at the church. Maybe some of you received a business card when you walked in the door. On the back of it says, who was Jesus? Why did he come? What does it mean to follow him? For those of us who do follow Jesus, we believe he is the ultimate expression of beauty. And so perhaps that could be a way you could continue this conversation at the Black Sheep Pub, May 20th, 27th, 6:30. Eat, listen, talk, do other things at the pub, and enjoy yourself with Liam Gallagher. And if anyone does have further questions from tonight, feel free to come forward. There'll be some of us who'd be happy to talk with you. Be happy to talk with you as well. Thank you, Mr. Kim, as well. Thank you for your comments. Thanks, everyone. Have a great night.